Kia ora, I'm Miriama Kamo. Sir Bob Parker led Christchurch through its devastating earthquakes. But not so long ago, Sir Bob himself was struck down. His brain and body are forever changed. Tonight, Sir Bob and his wife, Lady Jo, invite us into their raw, deeply personal journey of recovery. Plus, we have a medical breakthrough, a warning for the young, and the advice that could save your life. Jahan Kasanada has this exclusive story.
Do you get nervous when you go in front of a camera?
Sure. There are times you do.
I still get nervous too.
Do you?
I'm a bit nervous now, to tell you the truth.
Good on you. Glad to hear you're telling the truth about it.
If anyone should feel relaxed in front of a camera...
Thank you very much. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
It's Sir Bob Parker.
He's really coming here to take part in This Is Your Life.
For over 30 years, he's been in our living rooms, in good times and bad.
I've just declared a state of emergency.
After rebuilding a shattered city, he now faces an even greater challenge, rebuilding himself.
Is the old Sir Bob, the real Sir Bob, still there?
Yeah, that's what's very cool about this. I haven't lost my husband.
You haven't?
No.
Hidden away in central Christchurch.
Wow.
An old warehouse converted into a chic apartment by Sir Bob Parker and his wife, Lady Jo.
We sort of cut back the concrete floors, put in some ceilings, you know, it's become home.
Few good parties here over the years?
There's been a few.
The pair first met on stage. They were in a play together.
I played the lead female and Sir Bob was playing the lead male.
And what did you make of him?
I thought he was pretty handsome. I thought he was quite articulate.
They got hitched in 2007, the same year Sir Bob became the mayor of Christchurch. His tenure would be like no other. When the big quake hit in February 2011, Lady Jo was in the council building.
It was quite spectacular being up on the seventh floor because we could see dust rising and all of that noise and all of the car alarms and, you know, everything that had fallen down around us.
In the chaos, Sir Bob swung into action.
We need to prepare ourselves for what is going to be a significant number of casualties.
His voice is very distinctive. People know his voice in New Zealand, and it, through the earthquakes, it was very calming.
We all must work together.
People said to him and through social media, you know, we just need to hear your voice.
The days were long and the pressure relentless.
The Japanese that died in the CTV building, their families came and sat down with Bob and basically said to him, how does it feel to be a murderer? Which was quite devastating for him. They needed to say that to him. They needed to say it to a leader of this city, that you're responsible for the people of this place. And he knows that, but he's also a human being and can only handle so much, you know?
What was the toll of his leadership?
In hindsight, I think there was a huge toll.
In 2013, Sir Bob stepped away from politics, exhausted.
I really did want him to stay healthy and fit, and he was doing it. He got a treadmill and he was walking, and then when it was a nice day, he'd be out in the park.
On a Monday morning last October, Lady Jo went for a run in Hagley Park by herself.
I came back at 9 o'clock. I heard this little tapping, and he was actually under the table on the floor.
Sir Bob had had a massive brain bleed. It paralysed him.
We have no movement whatsoever on the left-hand side of his body. So he's in a lot of pain.
Tell me about the last 6 months. It's been a bit tough, hasn't it?
I had a few health challenges to do with... What would they be, Joe?
You see, not only has the stroke affected his movement, it has also erased much of his life's work.
So, Bob, shall we take a trip down memory lane? How does that sound?
We have a group of four very, very beautiful, lovely young ladies who have just had the joy of meeting Princess Diana. Can you tell me, what did she say to you?
She said, thank you very much.
Do you remember this?
No.
This is you presenting a TV show back in the day. Look at those glasses.
Yeah, I had some huge glasses.
Thank you very much.
Who's that?
Who's that?
The star of...
The star of it is you. That's you.
Is it?
Yeah.
Who would believe that?
Does he know who he is?
Yeah, so that's the question. You know, he's not completely aware of himself.
What are we seeing here? What's going on here?
The Christchurch's new TV channel.
Yes, the building fell down in the earthquake.
Did it?
Yeah, the CTV building. This is you on the day of the earthquake.
Really?
Yeah.
Look at that. And honestly, this is the worst possible. Well, yeah. Is how far back in the building it actually is.
Do you remember any of this or no?
No.
You became quite famous for your orange jacket.
How come that became so famous?
It's because you were on TV every day, leading the city. Did you enjoy looking back at those old clips?
I did. That was cool, thank you.
So Bob, I have to ask, why did you agree to do this interview?
That was a good opportunity to do this for a personal task. As you can hear, I don't always speak straight. I'm just what I am.
There are about 11,000 strokes every year in New Zealand, so that's one every 45 minutes.
Joanna Lambert, head of the Stroke Foundation.
A stroke is effectively a brain attack. There's two types of stroke. There's a bleed or there is a blood clot. Both of these reduce the amount of oxygen that gets to the brain as well. And as a result, that part of the brain gets damaged and the cells can die. And if the cells die, then there's permanent loss of function as a result. In the next decade, we believe that stroke is going to increase by up to 40%. In New Zealand.
One of the big causes, high blood pressure.
We have this silent killer in our bodies that we aren't aware of. And until we are made aware that we have high blood pressure by having a blood pressure check, we are living with effectively a bit of a time bomb going on in our bodies.
On Wellington's waterfront,
put your arm through the hole.
Locals are getting free checkups.
The reason why more people are having strokes is because of the lifestyles that we lead. Lack of exercise, too much salt in our diet, high sugar in our diet, people are working longer hours, at stressful jobs. All of these factors contribute significantly to stroke.
I doubt you've had more than a few hours sleep since the quake, if any.
Yeah.
You're going to have to take it easy soon, aren't you?
I think we all have to think about that and be sensible. And look, I got actually 5 hours sleep last night, and that's like a month's holiday right now, and that was a huge sleep. So I'm not doing too badly.
What was it that happened for Bob? You know, was it the stress of politics? Who knows? But I do know that he asked a lot of himself. And maybe that's just over time taken its toll.
Sir Bob's lifeline to his past is Lady Jo.
Oh, Bob.
Oh, baby.
Hello.
Bob and I have been together 20 years, so we've been through a lot.
Do you like this one?
He's a real rock for me.
Look forward to seeing Joe each day?
I do. He's my favourite. In my whole world, Joanna is everything for me. It's a wee bit cold.
Just the smallest movements of his fingers, his arms, he's just in so much pain.
Start with your foot, Bob.
Some stroke survivors have a remarkable recovery in the first few months as their brains heal. That didn't happen for Sir Bob.
You don't wake up each day feeling like today is going to be a great day. Just wake up each day not really knowing what it'll be like at all.
What advice would you give to others who are going through a tough time?
I can't tell you much other than to say I'm with you, friend.
After months in a care facility, Sir Bob comes home for daytime visits.
And so just a long black?
It's about staying positive, really, and having purpose, because he'll regress quite a lot and he doesn't care about the things that I want him to care about anymore, you know. Only yesterday he fell out of bed because he decided he was going to get up and then forgot that his body wouldn't work, you know. So he's still going through a lot, and I realised that he was in the right place now.
In a facility?
Yeah, I think he needs to be there.
And I'm dedicating this song to Sir Bob because I know that he loves the Beatles. Imagine there's
no heaven. He's got this pure emotion.
It's easy if you try.
So all of that emotion is now just there, and it's a beautiful thing.
Imagine all the people.
Behind that beauty, a sobering warning for all of us.
People that are young and fit are having strokes and heart attacks too, you know? What's going on?
Coming up...
The doctors were just telling me, OK, you've just had a stroke.
The science bringing Kiwis back from the brink.
We removed the clot, saved their life. Literally.
And later... What's next for Sir Bob and Lady Jo?
We're just on a new part of our journey, you know, and I'm up for it.
So what are we making?
So we're going to make my chunky chocolate chip cookie.
For Sianoa Iloa, the kitchen is her happy place.
I'm currently running a business called Noah's Eats. I sell a homemade cookie with a little extra chocolate in there.
She's making a name for herself on social media and around Auckland.
You're going to give out the recipe on national TV?
Oh, wow, no.
Top secret.
Top secret. Top secret.
You wouldn't guess it, but at just 25, Sianoa had a brush with death.
Tell me about the day of the stroke. What do you remember?
I'd just gone into the bathroom and I'd finished. I'd gotten up to open the door and my body just collapsed. My body was just numb. In my head, I was thinking, I don't know what's happening, but what I'll do is I'll just unlock my phone, I'll call my partner.
Her brother climbed through the window before calling an ambulance and heading to hospital.
And the doctors were just telling me, okay, you've just had a stroke. I bawled my eyes out. Because the only thing that I thought about were the things that mattered to me most.
Like Moses, her seven-year-old son.
This child literally depends on me. I might not be able to, you know, take my son to school. I might not be able to drive him to his trainings or to, you know, just do motherly things that I would do on the daily.
That stroke could have ended your life.
Or if not ended my life, it would have really, like, debilitated me. I probably wouldn't be able to even be a mum.
Sianoa had a blood clot deep in her brain.
unless you remove the clot, the brain will die. Once the brain dies, that's it, it's not going to come back.
Professor Alan Barber, one of our top neurologists.
So when I was a junior doctor, someone came in with a stroke, there wasn't much you could do to reduce the damage apart from good nursing care and physio and speech-language therapy. In the last few years, we've had a major revolution in how we can treat stroke.
A groundbreaking new procedure, allowing surgeons to remove a clot.
We make a small cut in the femoral artery in the groin, so it's the big one here that pulses, put a catheter into that, and then we feed the catheter up. You can go all the way up into the brain and you can see where the blood stops flowing, and that's where the clot is, and actually go in, suck out the clot, and pull it out. This is unbelievably complex and requires a huge skill level.
And the results, well, they're stunning. Here's a photo of a real clot removed from a patient's brain at Auckland Hospital.
So you need people to get to hospital as soon as possible.
With that clot, you're losing 2 million brain cells a minute.
Wow.
The longer it takes to get to hospital, the more brain that dies, the worse you're gonna be. When the surgery goes well, it's transformative. Someone goes home the next day, normal, who could have been staring down the barrel of a life of disability.
So that surgery totally gave you your life back?
Yeah, pretty much. I went in that night as a stroke patient. The next morning, I was moving.
You were back to normal?
Yeah, back to normal.
Sianoa has regained the use of her whole body.
I'm gonna live my life to the fullest. I feel like it was God giving me a second chance. So what am I gonna do? Oh, I'm gonna grasp it with two hands and I'm gonna run with it.
Alan says Sianoa's story is a cautionary tale for young people.
I would see someone in their 20s with a stroke every 2 or 3 weeks. I would see someone in their 30s every couple of weeks. I see multiple people in their 40s every week.
Some people have an irregular heartbeat, putting them at a higher risk of stroke. For others, the biggest warning sign is high blood pressure.
Take a seat.
Over here?
Over there, that's the one.
And now, even if you're fit and healthy,
put your arm through the hole here, palm facing up.
You could be in for a surprise.
These results had better be good.
Unfortunately, it is a little bit on the higher side.
What? Is it?
Just for this reading. Now, the thing is, your blood pressure does go up and down throughout the day.
After a few minutes, we did the test again.
So that's good.
It's still a little bit on the higher side.
Oh, this one?
Yes, yes.
Oh, no. Yeah. Well, that's not good.
No.
What would be your advice?
My advice is that you go and see your GP.
Right.
Get some more readings done and see whether this is a consistent result.
So nothing to stress about?
I wouldn't be stressing just now, no. But I would definitely be getting some more readings and thinking about, you know, what changes you might make in your lifestyle. 75% of strokes are avoidable. Making small adjustments actually make a big difference.
It's been 8 months since Sir Bob Parker's stroke, and Lady Jo is determined to look after her own body.
Go, go, get those legs, go and get that up, get that up.
Today, checking her oxygen levels.
Well, I've been pretty latched on to my patterns with sport and exercise and being healthy because I'm of no use to him if I'm not well.
It's okay. Well done.
Hey, Bobby. Didn't expect to have a husband in the care facility, that's for sure.
Hey, how are you doing?
Waiting to see you.
Cool, you look good.
And I'm not always sure what I'm walking into when I walk into the room to see him, you know.
What, you got new socks? Where did you get those?
Anger or love or, you know, something thrown at me because he is just super emotional.
Sir Bob's stroke was caused by a brain bleed, so the clot surgery we showed you would not have helped him.
He didn't die, and he's fought through some very difficult times. We're just on a new part of our journey, you know? I don't know what this journey is going to be for me, but I'm up for it. I hope that he keeps positive and wants to explore new things with me.
Thank you.
I'll get a taxi and we'll go somewhere and we'll do things that are just trivial, like champagne and fries at a bar or something, you know, just because we can. He might not even really be inspired by that idea, but when he gets out, it's great to see him happy and just take his mind off himself a little, because he's caught in this body now.
Although part of his brain has died, there are moments when Sir Bob's memory comes to life.
I never saw myself as a leader. It was certainly a big job. I'm proud of what we did. I'm proud of what it was like to try to handle all that stuff.
I think he wants to be remembered. It's big for him. As a good man. So if we can achieve that for him, I think he'd be happy.
I'd just like to say thank you for being interested enough in coming to my city to find out something more about how we were.
It's been a real pleasure to talk to you.
Thank you.
Ai, te rangatira ngā mihi. And Sir Bob also has love and support from his wider family, including his three adult sons. So how do you recognise a stroke? Well, there's a handy acronym, FAST. So if someone's face is drooping, their arm is weak, or their speech is slurred, even just one of these symptoms, then take action. Get them to hospital fast.